Green is actually not the best color for plants to be. Red plants would be much better at getting energy out of sunlight because red absorbs sunlight better. Some red plants do exist, but they evolved after all the underlying mechanisms for green plants already existed. So in the end, they are not optimally equipped for photosynthesis either. A completely new kind of mechanism would have to evolve in order for red plants to be the best at energy absorption, but evolution doesn't work like that. It's a process that builds on what already existed before. Fins became legs, scales became teeth, mammal brains were layered over reptilian brains, and green plants turned red. Evolution does not, cannot care about optimization. Good enough works until it no longer does, and so living beings on Earth have evolved countless ways to survive long enough to pass their genetic material on to the next generation. And countless species have gone extinct in the 4.5 billion years life has existed on our planet. To us, Earth seems like the perfect world for life. After all, it's nothing but abundant on our planet. Life can be found in every nook and cranny, from the vast oceans to the scorching deserts. From the icy poles to the deepest, darkest caves. So logically, in the search for alien life, scientists tend to focus on worlds similar to our own. Smaller, rocky planets orbiting in the habitable zone of a sun-like star. So far, the only example we have of life in the universe is the life we can find here on Earth. We have no idea what alien life could look like. So we don't really have any other choice but to go with what we know, and even then, there's gaps in our knowledge. We still don't know exactly how life began on Earth in the first place. 4.5 billion years ago, our planet was a very different place, with an atmosphere that would have been completely toxic to current life, and our sun, in its youth, was a lot more active. So until we find a planet with obvious signs of life, all we can really do is speculate. But scientists don't do this willy-nilly. They understand the laws of physics, and so they can make educated guesses, come up with hypotheses that have a solid ground in reality as we understand it today. And so in 2014, astronomers Renee Heller and John Armstrong published a paper in which they introduced the concept of the superhabitable world, a place better suited for life than Earth. The idea is that while life is clearly perfectly possible on Earth, our planet may not be the best place for life. And assuming it is geocentric and anthropocentric in nature. In other words, we're not the center of everything. We're not the main characters of the universe. And Earth is just another planet among trillions in our galaxy alone. Of course it's important to us because this is the only home we've ever known, but that doesn't necessarily make it any better than any other random place. At the end of the day, we simply don't know what kinds of other worlds are out there, and there might just be planets where life is even more abundant and more diverse, and that alone would make that world better suited for life than our own. To our green Earth, a bigger, better, redder Earth might exist. Heller and Armstrong argue that a planet being in a star's habitable zone is by far not enough to be sure life can exist there, and they proposed a biocentric approach to habitability. Focusing on astrophysical characteristics that affect the abundance and variety of life on a world's surface. And so, a moon orbiting a gas giant that gets sufficiently heated by gravitational forces could also potentially be a superhabitable world outside of a stellar habitable zone. Either way, the type of star a potentially superhabitable world orbits is of key importance. In astronomy, stars are classified according to their spectral characteristics, the analysis of the light they emit, their composition and temperature. Stars on the main sequence are stars that are not in the process of being born or actively dying, but are steadily generating energy through nuclear fusion of hydrogen and helium in their cores. And they're divided into classes O, B, A, F, G, K, and M, with O being the hottest and bluest class, also known as blue giants or blue supergiants, and M being the coolest and reddest class, and more commonly known as red dwarf stars. Although going by spectral class, M-class stars also include red giants and red supergiants, like the bright star Betelgeuse in the constellation of Orion. However, red giants are quite rare, while the small, dim red dwarfs are the most common type of star in the universe. The most massive stars, OB and A-class, have average lifespans in the main sequence that are considered too short for complex life to develop, ranging from a few hundred million years for A-type stars to only a few million for the massive O-type stars. Essentially, the more massive a star, the shorter its lifespan. Since its energy output is so much greater, it burns through its fuel much quicker than lower mass stars. So F-class stars are considered the hot limit for stars that could potentially host life. Their lifespans of 2 to 4 billion years could be enough for complex life to develop. However, F-class stars emit large amounts of ultraviolet radiation. If potentially habitable worlds have no protective ozone layer, this radiation could destroy life on a planet's surface. On the opposite end, the low-mass red dwarfs are by far the most common long-lived stars in the universe, and could potentially exist for a trillion years or more. In fact, the universe itself hasn't existed long enough yet for any red dwarfs to be in the later stages of their life cycles. Their long and stable lifespans make them seem ideal energy sources for life on red dwarf planets, but ongoing research points to serious challenges to their ability to support life. Red dwarfs don't emit a lot of energy, and so their habitable zones are much closer to the star than of more luminous stars like our Sun, for instance. And so any planets in this sort of close proximity to their host star become tidally locked. One side always faces their Sun, and one side always faces away, just like Earth's moon. By default, such worlds couldn't be super habitable because even if life could exist in that narrow, moderate band of eternal twilight between the planet's fixed hot day side and cold night side, that wouldn't allow for life to become more abundant and diverse than it is here on Earth. Another major concern is that even a low-mass red dwarf has a tendency for frequent outbursts of high-energy radiation early in its life, which has the potential to strip away any planet's atmosphere, and that wouldn't benefit any budding life forms at all. At the same time, a red dwarf's general output of UV radiation outside of outbursts is not high enough to support biological processes like photosynthesis. In short, too much energy is bad, but so is too little. Our Sun is a G-class star, a so-called yellow dwarf, even though the Sun's light is simply white, even if it appears yellowish to us through Earth's atmosphere. G-class stars seem great for life, evidently. However, Heller and Armstrong argue that a limiting factor to the habitability of Sun-like yellow dwarfs is the need for an ozone layer to absorb most of the star's ultraviolet radiation and protect any life forms on a planet's surface. If the ozone layer of Earth's atmosphere disappeared entirely, we would all get skin cancer and die. In fact, the ozone layer isn't equally thick all over the world, and for instance, people in Australia and New Zealand have to protect themselves better from the sun because the ozone layer is thinner there. And so, the perfect type of star to host a super habitable world would be a slightly less massive star than the sun, a so-called K-type orange dwarf, also nicknamed a Goldilocks star. Orange dwarfs emit low enough levels of UV radiation to eliminate the need for an ozone layer, but still enough to contribute to necessary biological processes. These stars live quite a lot longer as well, 18 to 34 billion years compared to the only 10 billion years the sun will shine for. And so orange dwarfs provide a more stable habitable zone for a much longer time, giving life more time to develop and become diverse. Keeping in mind that as a star ages, it slowly becomes more luminous and hotter, and so its habitable zone moves outward over time. Orange dwarfs are also 50% more common than yellow dwarfs in the Milky Way. Okay, now we've talked about which star would be better than the sun for life. Obviously, the characteristics of a planet itself are equally important and include things like age, orbit and rotation, size, mass, geology, and surface features, and of course, its climate. The age of a potentially superhabitable world matters because, as we see on Earth, biodiversity increases over time, since native species have had more time to evolve, adapt, and stabilize their environment so it better supports life. Over the course of 4.5 billion years, Earth's characteristics have been profoundly changed by life existing here. From the amount of oxygen in the atmosphere to the enormous swaths of landmass covered in vegetation. And recently, human activity changes the climate at an alarming rate. Research suggests the earliest rocky planet started to form about 12 billion years ago. In the past, it was believed that rocky planets most likely didn't exist this early in the universe because, in the beginning, the most abundant elements were, and still are, hydrogen and helium. The heavier elements that make up rocky planets were forged in the cores of stars over time and spread across space when they died, or formed from extremely energetic supernova explosions or collisions between neutron stars. It used to make sense to assume rocky planets wouldn't form until enough heavier elements existed, but the Kepler Space Telescope discovered many rocky planets orbiting stars with low metallicity. In other words, they could form from clouds of gas and dust that did not contain a lot of heavy elements, and these findings suggest that rocky, Earth-sized planets could have started to appear as early as 1 billion years after the Big Bang. Life on a 12 billion year old rocky planet would have had plenty of time to develop greater diversity than life on Earth, and so a super habitable world would be older than our planet. Like I mentioned earlier, a star's habitable zone is in fact not stable throughout its life. During the main sequence phase, a star produces energy by fusing hydrogen and helium in its core. Over time, as the hydrogen fuel is consumed, the star's core contracts and heats up. And all that extra pressure leads to a higher rate of fusion, and so the star slowly becomes more luminous. As the luminosity increases, the amount of energy the star puts out also increases, and so the habitable zone gets pushed outward. Any planet has a limited amount of time within the habitable zone, known as its habitable zone lifetime. Studies suggest that Earth's orbit lies near the inner edge of the Sun's habitable zone, with the Sun already 5 billion years old and about halfway its life. In just a few more billion years, it will become so hot that Earth at its current orbit will fall out of the habitable zone. Ideally, the orbit of a superhabitable world should be further out and closer to the center of its star's habitable zone, but again, being in a habitable zone does not guarantee life can exist on a planet, and so it ultimately doesn't say much about a world's habitability. One example of a world that may host life beyond the stellar habitable zone is Jupiter's moon Europa, which may have a huge ocean under a thick crust of ice, kept warm by tidal heating caused by the gravitational interactions the moon has with the other Galilean moons and Jupiter itself. Other orbital factors that may play an important role are axial tilt and the eccentricity of a planet's orbit. Axial tilt is responsible for Earth's seasons, and a 2023 paper by Jonathan Jernigan and colleagues suggests that planets with a greater axial tilt and/or eccentricity may be superhabitable. Because it seems more exaggerated seasons than those on Earth can increase marine biological activity. Basically, a bigger difference in seasons could affect the amount of nutrients in the oceans and makes for warmer poles that have less ice coverage, so there's more room for life to exist there. Now, axial tilt is just one factor in this. A world with a small tilt but a very eccentric orbit is also going to experience seasons. Summer as it's approaching its star and winter at the furthest point in its orbit. Now, too great of an eccentricity may take a planet in and out of a habitable zone, so that will likely have significant effects on any life in such a place. The majority of exoplanets discovered so far are gas giants similar to Jupiter and Saturn, for the simple fact that they're much bigger and easier to detect. The first exoplanet was found in 1992, but it wouldn't be until 2005 that the first possible candidates for rocky planets were found. And it wasn't until 2011 that the first ones were officially confirmed, from data gathered by the Kepler Space Telescope, which was specifically designed to detect these kinds of small worlds. Going by what we know of the chemistry of life, it seems entirely unlikely that it can exist in the volatile atmospheres of gas giants. And so our focus is on the more stable terrestrial planets. Superhabitable worlds would ideally be somewhat bigger than Earth, assuming that a greater surface area would provide for greater biodiversity. You simply have more room for life to do its thing, and such a world could hold down a thicker and more stable atmosphere. Studies of planetary physics suggest that the upper limit for rocky planets seems to be twice the mass and 1.7 times the radius of Earth. Bigger planets than that become gaseous so-called mini-Neptunes, which likely have icy or rocky cores or mix of both with thick hydrogen-helium atmospheres and, underneath, possibly liquid oceans made up of water, ammonia, or both. A bigger rocky planet will generate internal heat for longer, which is a major contributing factor to plate tectonics. Too much mass, however, can slow plate tectonics down because of greater pressure on the planet's mantle. And so it seems the ideal size for a superhabitable world is between 1.2 and 1.3 times the radius of Earth, a so-called super-Earth. Speaking of plate tectonics, they should be common on rocky planets with a significant rotation speed and an internal heat source, the molten interior of a world. But really, the surface of the Earth is a very thin layer, no thicker than the peel of an apple if you can scale it down to that size. If large bodies of water are present on a planet, plate tectonics can help maintain high levels of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, coming from volcanic activity. Carbon dioxide gets a bad rep as a greenhouse gas, but the greenhouse effect is responsible for keeping Earth warmer than it would be without it, and so it prevents the oceans from freezing over completely. The problem we currently have with greenhouse gases is that we've been pumping too much of them into the atmosphere too fast, which is causing the climate to change faster than it ever has naturally, bar disasters like meteor impacts and giant volcano eruptions. And so this causes the weather to go haywire, with extreme heat waves and extreme storms as a consequence. A runaway greenhouse effect will make a world too hot for life to thrive or even exist in the first place, so you need a good balance of gases in the atmosphere, so your world isn't permanently frozen or basically an oven. Another important geological factor for any potentially habitable world is the presence of a magnetic field. Earth's magnetic field is generated by the dynamo effect of having electrically conducting molten iron in its core, and a significant enough rotation speed to trigger this dynamo effect. Venus is in many ways similar to Earth, but it rotates much too slow to generate a proper magnetic field. Such a field protects a planet's surface from harmful ionizing radiation from space and its sun. A habitable moon may be protected by the magnetic field of its host planet. Less massive worlds, and ones that are tidally locked, likely have weak or non-existent magnetic fields. Over time, they will slowly lose most of their atmosphere and become desert worlds similar to Mars. Some of the best places for biodiversity on Earth are found in tropical climates. A superhabitable world would ideally have similar conditions all over it, due to the denser atmosphere and less temperature variations all over its surface. Earth's average temperature is about 15 degrees Celsius, but since biodiversity was greater when our planet was warmer in the distant past, a superhabitable planet's average temperature should be optimal for plant life, around 25 degrees Celsius. It wouldn't have any major ice sheets and a higher concentration of clouds. Earth has many different kinds of environments, from frigid tundra and taiga forests, rainforests, deserts, mountains, shallow and deep oceans, but not all of these are great for life, even if it manages to exist there. The Sahara Desert isn't exactly known for its biodiversity, but in tropical rainforests, you can find the most variety in species on our entire planet. So logically, a superhabitable world would be just like that, warm and moist, and essentially all landmass would be covered in vegetation. One huge alien rainforest. And given the difference in peak wavelengths of light these plants would receive from their K-type star, evolution might just take a different path, and they could be red, orange, or even purple. Another environment that's great for biodiversity are shallow, warm oceans. So a superhabitable world would not have major continents, but rather its landmass would be broken up in many small bits. Particularly large continents, like Earth's past Gondwana, for example, tend to have vast, inhospitable deserts in the middle, far away from oceans, and so harder for any life to reach. And of course, too dry and too hot for most life forms. There wouldn't be any deep oceans on such a world either, since those are too cold and dark for many life forms to thrive in. And so, the whole idea of a superhabitable world basically comes down to all the best things that Earth has to offer. Just bigger, better, and possibly redder. Now, the main challenge remains finding worlds like this. Earth-sized or somewhat larger planets are difficult to detect, even around relatively nearby stars. The future will see better instruments for finding such worlds and better study their size and temperature and the composition of their atmosphere. Finding an almost exact twin of Earth would for sure be very exciting, but the concept of the superhabitable planet reminds us of the many possibilities that can exist in the universe. Thank you for watching. I hope you learned something new today. If you have any questions or anything to add, that's what the comment section is for. And I will see you in the next video.